Today's video for February 11th in Video-a-Day February takes a look at first dates, since this channel is one that promotes healthy relationships. First dates are part of that. If you don't go on a first date, then you certainly won't make it up to an engagement and a marriage. So a first date, even though they're a pain in the butt, are a necessary evil in this whole process. So it just so happened I had one letter in place that I was going to use for this month, and then another one came in, not necessarily a letter, it was more of a comment, but it, the way she posted on the channel, but it did have some questions that related to my first date topic, so I decided to include it in this video. So we're going to look at two women asking questions about first dates. The comment that came in on the channel says, "I love your videos. I've learned so much, but I have a question. Could you make a video on going on a first date? Should we meet in the middle at a restaurant, or should our date come to us? Should the men set up the date, or should we be asked what we like and they make the plans? I would like to know these details when I start to date again. Currently, I am working on myself and not putting myself in a position to get played again. Thank you." Okay. Let me address a couple of things here first before we move on into and get a little deeper. Should you meet in the middle? So I'm assuming that means that they're a good distance apart. Some people do that. I would never do that because I feel like if you continue to see this guy, he's going to be coming to you. If he's interested, he will come to you. There are guys who go from the San Francisco area to LA every weekend to see a woman they're interested in. Do you know how far that is? 600 miles. That's 600 miles. They will drive down there or they will fly down there, but they go to see the woman that they're interested in. So you got a guy who can't even drive 30 minutes and you want to make it easy on him by meeting in the middle? Hell no. If he can't drive 30 minutes and he's got a car, then he don't need to date you. He needs to date somebody who's more geographically desirable. Which is what I do. That's my rule anyway. If I can't get to you and you can't get to me in like no more than 15 minutes, then we not gonna date. That's too far. Should the men set up the date, or should we be asked what we like and they make the plans? Now, if you're going to dinner, it would certainly behoove him to ask what kind of food that you like, because there might be something that really disgusts and grosses you out that he likes. You may be like me and not eat meat. So you trying to take me to Ruth Chris's Steakhouse to impress me is going to bomb really flat. So you should the guy should definitely ask what woman's preferences are if he's taking her out for a meal. If they're going to some kind of event, or you know, anything else, a museum or an art exhibit, whatever, then he doesn't have to ask what she would like. He would just tell her, "I have tickets to go to this thing here on this date and this time. Are you interested in attending with me?" So he gives you then out. I mean, maybe you don't like, this guy asked me to go to a poetry slam thing with him. I was like, oh my God, I'd rather gouge my eyes out. Are you kidding me? Even though he was cute, he had an interest that I just had no interest in. And even though I occasionally write some poetry, it's something that comes out like maybe once every 5 or 6 years. So that was a bomb. They definitely, there should definitely be some conversation about where you go and what you do. That's why simple dates for the first date are my preference. You know, meet for coffee, meet for ice cream, meet for tea, meet for a sandwich lunch. I mean, you know, meet for a burger. I mean, whatever you do, it should be something light, and it should be something that has a time limit on it. That's why I like lunch dates for first dates, because everybody got to get back to work. So you only have an hour, maybe 90 minutes if you're lucky, and then you got to go. So you got a built-in escape in case it's dreary and he's boring. And so she says she'd like to know those details. And so those are my answers to your questions. You will get more answers as we proceed through this video and I address some other issues that come up with first dates. Okay, so let's go on to the second letter now, which was actually the first one that came in. She says, "I broke up with my 4-year boyfriend back in early November. After a couple of months, I decided it was time to stop licking my wounds and see what was out there. So I did like everyone else and signed up for an online dating site. Oh my God, here we go. Last Saturday night, I had a first date with one of the guys I met on the site. I was surprised at how well we got along. We laughed a lot during the dinner, and I had a good time. A really good time with him. We talked not only about politics, books, and movies, but went deeper and discussed dealing with breakups, death, and his divorce, amongst other things. He called me on his cell phone during his drive home and kept going on and on about how much he enjoyed the evening. I reiterated that I enjoyed it too. Okay, so here's the kicker. An hour or so after I got home, he sent a text that said, "I think you're beautiful. My female friends tell me that they know how far they want to go with a man from the moment they meet him. Well, how far do you want to go with me?" So I texted back, "How far? It depends on how well you woo and court me." His response was, "Court you? I need some vajayjay now, LOL. I was a bit taken aback at his bluntness and wrote back to say, "Well, I'm looking for something long term. I'm sure there are hundreds of loose women out there if you just can't wait." Wow, this guy is just too much. And so he says that he's just kidding. "I'm a gentleman. Is teasing not allowed?" Me, "Oh, you were just kidding? I wasn't sure, because a lot of men these days ask women for sex on the first or second date. Good night." This has really been bothering me, so much so that I'm writing to an online advice columnist to get your opinion. What do you think of his behavior? Keep in mind, we are in our late 40s, not terribly young people without a lot of dating and relationship experience. Should I give him a second chance or not? She signed her letter, "Modern Dating, Yuck." So, what would I say to this? Okay. You know, sometimes it just seems like, you know, like I said in my video, men don't get wiser when they get older. They just get older. They were stupid when they were young, and they're stupid when they're older. The only difference is they're older. And so, you know, you're looking for a man to show some maturity and development, and then they hit you with stuff like that, like they're 14. So it's like, you know, what is wrong with you? And then when you add that, what I call the electronic courage factor, these dudes will send these, you know, suggestive texts to women and you know, pictures that they shouldn't be sending. You know what I'm talking about. And which are things that they would never have the nerve to do or say to her face to face, or even if they're on the phone. So they do it through text. And it just is very disappointing to see what should be mature men acting like adolescents. I just can't stand it. But thinking about this, there's two schools of thought on his behavior and what your response might be. Now, there's one group of people who would say, you know, don't be such a stick in the mud. You know, he was just kidding around. He was just joking around. Even though what he said was in poor taste, you should just give him another chance. Can't you take a joke? It was no big deal. You know, it didn't hurt you. He was, you know. So anyway, they make excuses for his crass behavior. And then there's the other group that would say, you know, he's like an immature knucklehead, trolling personal sites looking for some booty calls, and you would do well to get rid of him immediately, if not sooner. And I'm in that group. Because, see, my thing is this. My belief is that if you got, you know, you're just a grown man, right? If he truly is looking for a woman with some sense and a woman with some class, and he claims that he's a gentleman, then that means that he should be respecting her. He should be wanting to go out of his way to make a good impression, because he, you know, expressed how much he liked to spend time with her and how much a good time he had, you know, and she seemed to feel the same way. So a guy who was really trying to make a good impression would just be much too conscious about what that woman would think about him to say anything like that to her. He wouldn't want to take the chance that he would mess things up, and that she would think of him as being nothing but, you know, some kind of idiot. So telling a woman that he doesn't even know that he wants something to JJ is definitely not gentlemanly behavior. I don't know what alternate universe definition of gentleman he's using, but it's not, it ain't the same as mine. Now, what's really interesting is, you know, this letter, I talked about it with a couple of women I know, and it was just interesting to me to see the difference, because many of them thought that, you know, that he was that it was flattering. They thought that he found them attractive and so sexy and mesmerized by her beauty that he lost all control of his brain and his mouth. And I'm like, what? You know, they don't understand that when a dude has just one game like this guy has, he's not a real player. He don't have, he, you know, he doesn't even know how to, like, customize his game. His game is like mud. He just throw it against the wall. Any wall will do. And he just see if some sticks or not. That's the kind of dude he is. He didn't take any time to understand who he just had spent those hours with having dinner. He just like totally ignored it. That's her sign right there. He's not trying to get to know you. To him, you are nothing but, I mean, it's like, you know, he didn't say that he found you interesting. He didn't say that he found you sexy. He didn't say that he couldn't wait to see you again. He didn't say any of those kind of things that would let you know that he was truly interested in moving forward in a relationship. He just wanted to see if you, you know, could come off all disrespectful and see if you were open to his suggestion to some early bedroom activity. That's all he was doing. It's like, and if you had been open to it and told him to come over and gave text him your address or something, he would have been right over there. And so, I don't know. He doesn't care if you're a lady. He doesn't care what kind of qualities you're looking for. He doesn't care about anything. This dude, like, objectified this woman all the way down to her being nothing but a vajayjay and something for him to use to meet his own needs. So this guy to me is sorely lacking in social skills, or he's so misogynistic and narcissistic and sociopathic and all of them things that he doesn't care if he's insulting and rude to the women he meets or not. He just doesn't care. He just wants to see, you know, what's going to happen and what he can get out of these women. So since this woman is new to the dating scene, she doesn't realize, especially online. See, I don't do online dating. I've never even seen Tinder work or any of these swiping apps or anything like that. I have no interest in them at all. When I first started my blog, I signed up for, you know, several different online dating sites because I wanted to see, you know, I wanted to experience it from various people's perspective. So I had a perf profile that was a male profile, and I used a picture of a guy at my job. His girlfriend knew what was going on, so it was no problem. And, you know, we just made up a profile, and it was just so interesting to see the women just like going after, because dude was fine, little cute little white guy. And these chicks were, you know, asking for his address so they could send him panties that they had worn and all kind of stuff. They were all kind of gifts. They wanted to send him money, airplane tickets to fly in and see them. And then I had a profile as a woman, of course. And, you know, the guys were just very misogynistic, very sexist, and just like treating the women like they were nothing but prostitutes. It was terrible. So I don't, you know, y'all who do online dating, you are some brave souls, because I couldn't do it. I the thought of it just makes my skin itch. But for her, you know, she's coming back on the dating scene after 4 years. So I think, and this is a good idea for women who may be in a similar position. You gotta use your phone to your advantage. Okay, so you talk to the dude, or you know send emails back and forth through the dating site. You know, you need to ask some screening questions, because you might not even want to meet him after you figure out, you know, how he thinks. You got to figure out how these guys think, and not, oh, we both like chocolate, you know, and we both like bowling, and we both like the Oakland Raiders, and we both like, you know, certain, this kind of movie. You got to know how these clowns think, and, you know, how they perceive women. That's the number one thing. So you need to ask some very important and pointed questions. Point two is, you have to be sure not to tell him too much about what you are looking for. Because if he's a slick kind of dude, he's just going to parrot it back what you said. So you say, oh, you know, I want a guy who's looking for, you know, a long-term relationship. Oh, yeah, me too. You know, I want a guy who, you know, it understands my work schedule. Yeah, me too. You know, he's going to tell you what he thinks you want to hear, because it's going to be the most direct route to those panties. So you also have to, this is point three, is not be overly trusting. You know, I have a whole video on this site about women telling too much to men. And this is like a fatal error that many women make. These days, it's not only likely to get you robbed or something, you know, identity theft. I mean, they'll clean your whole account out, or open up credit cards in your name with your social security number and all this stuff, because you gave too much information. So you got to not be so trusting. Don't give out personal information either, like where you work or your home address. You know, you meet them out for dates. You don't let them pick you up, because you don't know this clown. And number four, don't worry too much about being nice to men that, you know, come off like this clown. You know, she was very polite to him. I would have cussed his behind out and slammed the phone down and put his phone number on block. That's me. But she was very, you know, respectful. But I'm just saying, I mean, if that's your personality, then of course you handle things in a way that works for you. But it's not something that you need to go out of your way to do. When they come at you disrespectfully, you know, in a sexist manner, or they're looking for something that you aren't and they're very crass about it, or they're married, then, you know, you don't need to worry about being nice to them. Just get rid of them as expeditiously as possible. And remember that you, anybody that you meet on your first date, they grosses you out, they make you uncomfortable, they put you in a position where you have to overlook irritating behavior, you know, just to stay on the date. That's some place you don't need to be with some person that you don't need to be with. Remember that you don't owe anybody your time. You don't owe them crap. You know, you agreed to go on a date with them, but that agreement can be revoked at any moment because of their behavior. And just because they want something from you doesn't mean you have to give. You're not obligated. So I think a lot of women, you know, just they really have a lot of trouble saying no to these guys. And yeah, that's not going to happen. Leave me alone. You're stupid. You know, this kind of stuff. They really struggle with that. But, you know, no is my favorite word. And in one of my videos, I talked about no, saying no, the beauty of no, hell no, fuck no, what I look like no, all kind of embellishments to no, because, you know, sometimes you just gotta do it like that. So let's talk about the reasons why people would be going on a date. Now, this pertains to letter number one as well as number two. Why do people date? Obviously, you know, there may be some discrepancies here. You may be dating for one reason, and the person that you're dating is dating for another one of these five reasons. But, you know, it works best when you're both on the same page, and then the dates can actually be meaningful and a fun, and you can discover what it is you're there to discover. So here are the five reasons according to Deb. Number one, to sow your wild oats. You know what I mean. With whomever catches your fancy. These are people who have no intention of committing to anyone anytime soon. They just out to get their freak on as much as possible with everybody that they can. In this day and age, of course, that is very risky, high risk behavior, but there are people who still do that, as in the guy that this lady met. Number two, purely for the fun and entertainment of meeting new people. Some people, you know, they might be fresh out of a relationship. They're not really ready to settle down and be with any one person. They just want to have a good time, and they like, you know, meeting new people and getting out, you know, trying new things, going new places, and just finding out what else is out there. Number three, to alleviate boredom or loneliness. You know, basically, these are people that don't have anything better to do. So somebody asks them out, they say yes, even though they really don't really have any interest in the person who's asking them. They just figure they may as well go because they don't have anything better going on. Number four, some people date because they've had a series of really disastrous encounters or a bad relationship. And they realize when they think about it, you know, I didn't really have any clue about what it was that I really need. I kind of have a better idea, but I'm going to date around to get an idea of what I don't want and maybe meet some people that are what I, you know, would have qualities that I do want. So they're kind of in an experimental phase. They're more serious about it than the ones who are, you know, looking for fun and entertainment, because their eventual goal is to settle down. But at the moment, they're in an exploratory phase. And if they meet somebody that they click with, then they will be ready to settle down. But they're not overly interested in a commitment. They're basically trying to figure themselves out by meeting different people and, you know, finding out what they're all about. So it's dating with a good intent. And then the final one are the people who are deadly serious. They're dating because they have a goal in mind. They want to meet their future husband or wife, and they want to have somebody to settle down with. So they're not trying to waste not 5 seconds of their time on frivolity and silliness, and they will let you know. So those are the top five reasons that I could think of. Of course, if you could think of some more, I would be happy to hear them. Okay, so let's talk about what's the goal of the first date. You know, people don't seem to understand what are you doing here. Your purpose is to discuss things with this person and find out if you have enough common ground and if you have enough things to see life in a similar fashion, have some some compatible experiences and goals and enough interest in each other to warrant a second date. That's what the purpose of the first date is. It's a screening tool. You know, you can do so much on the phone, but there's a lot that's communicated with body language, you know, looking at someone's face and they're seeing their expressions, that is really kind of mandatory if anything's going to really be jumping off. That's why I have a problem with these long distance relationships, because they don't really spend any time around each other. You know, how is this person? Really, after a few hours, I mean, what are they like? You need to be around them in their presence to know, and that's what dating does for you. So let's talk about some conversation starters, because people have some very odd conversation. You know, I go out and I hear people, you know, because everybody on these internet dates, right? And they sit there and, well, what kind of movie do you like? Oh, where did you go to school? Oh, do you know so-and-so? Well, where's your church home? Well, do you, you know, what books do you like? I mean, those are cute little questions and stuff, but, you know, those are teenage questions. You in your 30s and 40s and late 20s, and you looking for a mate, you need to, like, up the ante here and come at this with a lot more maturity and focus. So you need to ask questions like, you know, that are going to, like, really get the person that you're on a date with to think and to tell you stuff that's important about them. Okay, so as some examples, these are questions I've actually asked people. What's the one thing that you can't say no to? Usually it's something to eat, but sometimes, you know, it's like an activity. If you could live anywhere in the world, where would it be? Another one, what was the last really adventurous thing that you've done? And another one, when you were a little kid, what did you want to be when you grew up? Now, that's a great question, because people, it never fails that you see a smile on their face when they start reminiscing about what they wanted to be when they were a little kid. Sometimes it's silly stuff like, you know, I wanted to be a cowboy or, you know, whatever. But, you know, usually people had a dream that they formed at a very early age. It gives you some real insight into that person's past. And those are good because they get people to open up, right? And they get you talking about stuff that they normally wouldn't talk to anybody about. I mean, how many people ask the people questions like that? Think about it. Other ones were like, okay, well, when you were a little kid, what was your favorite toy? Or what was the best present that anybody ever gave you, or that you ever gave to someone? That, you know, either one. If your house was on fire, what's the first thing that you'd grab? What's one of your favorite books or movies and why? What was your worst job? What's the best advice anyone ever gave you? What was your favorite childhood toy? What's a secret skill that you have and nobody knows about? What's the bravest thing that you've ever done? So see, those are the kind of things, you know, you get to know, you get to learn someone. Because sometimes they're like, oh, I don't know, I didn't really have any favorites. Oh, I didn't ever want to be anything. I just sort of, okay, you're boring. That person is either boring or they don't want to be known. Either one of those are impediments to building a long-term, passion-based, romantic relationship. It's not going to happen. Not with somebody like that. They don't want you to know who they are. And so they're putting up the roadblocks from the gate. And you already know that's not going to go anywhere. So when you have these, when you're trying to, you know, you're on your first date and you're trying to get to know somebody and figure out if you guys have something in common, if you can create some kind of rapport with this person, you got to find something that you can relate to each other on. You know, these conversation starters that I gave you are, I mean, you know, it'll form a foundation that you can build on from there. Because, you know, when they talk about whatever their favorite toy was when a kid, then you can talk about yours. I mean, maybe it was the same thing, or maybe your brother or sister had, you know, the toy that they liked or whatever. And you guys, you know, it'll give you something to talk about. And then you can use that as a segue to talk about, you know, your early family things. I mean, always talking about your parents. And the crazy stuff they used to do is always a hoot. I mean, I always enjoy hearing about other people's crazy parents, because I know mine were nuts. And, if you're talking about something good, you want to create a positive emotional state in your date. You want them to be associating you with pleasant memories smiles, laughter, and fun and peace. Okay, if you have the ability to do that like I do, then you can always get a second date. You might not want the second date, but you can always get it because you would have established that kind of rapport with someone where they like feel like, wow, you know, I really told her, I must really like her because I told her stuff I would never tell anybody. I was really talking about myself. This is kind of weird. But men, most men we know are narcissistic and they love to talk about themselves. So they'll be fascinated with the fact that they talked about themselves and you listened and were interested. So they'll think, wow, this is good. I need to keep her around because she listens to me and she makes me feel good. Men are so trippy. So, you know, if you can ignite those kind of emotions in the guy, you know, you pretty much will be guaranteed a second date because he will find you fascinating for that reason. And, you know, you want to do topics that basically they keep the conversation flowing. You don't want to ask questions that can be answered with a yes, no, I don't know, maybe, that kind of stuff. You want him to have to use some words. And, you know, express what he likes, express his desires, get him to open up. And, you know, then you can open up and you can chime in too and open up yourself a little bit. But it's basically like you're fishing and you threw out a hook with the bait on it and he bit. And so now you guys are talking and it's all very good. So you want a conversation also where you can display qualities about yourself that are attractive. You know, you can show yourself as being fun or adventurous or well-read or creative or, I don't know, loving, supportive of your community. You want to pick topics that allow you to showcase yourself in a good way so that he's like, wow, you know, she really is cool. She's a cool person. She really cares about people. You know, you want him to have a good opinion of you. So what kind of things are good? You know, music, of course, people always talk about music, food, travel, those kind of things, pop culture stuff. But I prefer early childhood memories, things that you dream of, your ambitions, maybe some stuff that's going on or in the, you know, vicinity around you. That's always kind of fun. Unusual experiences that you've had. I like to tell about my ghost stories. This kind of freaks some of the dudes out, but most are fascinated by it. Lessons that you've learned or life lessons that you've learned are always a good topic too. You know, what have you learned since you were 20? I wish you knew at 20 that you know now. Something along those lines. Other questions that are kind of interesting is, what's one thing about you that would surprise me? What is it that's just really not evident about you just from first glance? What's your ideal dinner guest? If you could invite somebody from the past or the present to have dinner with you, who would it be and why? That would be kind of interesting. Mine would be, I'd want to have dinner with Tupac, James Baldwin, and Harriet Tubman. Those would be my three. I'd like to have dinner with them. I would just probably be so excited. I probably wouldn't be able to speak though, but I would still like to be there. What's your favorite dessert? Okay, then you say, you know, if they had, if the sky was the limit, they could do anything that they wanted to do, any kind of job, what would that job be? Where's their favorite place that they travel to? And then, you know, you want them to describe it and talk about why they like it so much and to paint you a picture of how wonderful it was so you could feel like you're there. And a person who really loves someplace is really creative in that way will be able to do that. So those are some ideas that I have about first dates. You know, it should not involve anything physical because you don't know what this person's all about yet. And a lot of people can put on a front on a first date, even up to the 10th date. You know, as this layer start peeling back like an onion, you finally get to see who and what they really are. So you guys take your time. You know, there needs to be more conversation. That's why I spent so much time in this video giving you ideas for things to talk about, because you need to know how your mate thinks, How does he think? What does he think about? How does he analyze situations? What are things that are meaningful to him? Because he may look good. You know, he may have the right career, all the stuff I talked about in the last video. You know, he looked good on paper. But you find out that he's an idiot. That he has some really weird misogynistic views about women. That he's like a caveman or something. I mean, just weird. So you don't want to go on a second date with a dude like that. You want him to forget he ever even saw your face, really. But those are my suggestions on first date do's and don'ts. So you want to definitely ask questions, and you don't want to do anything too physical or get too intimate or give out too much information to a person you really don't know. You don't know who this person is. And, you know, watch your drinks, too. If you get up from the table and you had a drink there, when you come back, get a new one. Don't be brand new. I don't know, these fools be slipping people roofies and stuff. You better watch your food and watch your drinks at every moment. And anytime you don't eat it. Don't drink it. I don't care what it is. Ask for a new glass of water, everything. So be very careful out here, ladies. These people ain't playing with you. But anyway, I'll be back tomorrow with another video. I guess I'll do the one on low self-esteem and for guys. And I want to thank you again for listening to each one of these windy videos, because I'm just talking my butt off. And again, if you have any ideas for topics for this month or in the future, feel free to send me an email to survivingdating@gmail.com. Do not put your ideas on the YouTube wall. People keep doing that, and I'm seeing them like a month or two later. You know, you guys, because I don't see all the comments. So, you know, you have to send me the email. Then I put them in a folder, and when I need a topic, I will go there and get it. So please do that. I would love to do the topics that you suggest, but if I don't see it, I'm not psychic, okay? I need to be able to see it. So email it to me, and then we have a better chance of you getting a response in video form to your question. This is Deb Cooper from survivingdating.com. I'll see you guys tomorrow.